Hello friends, so today we are going to learn a new poem called Lochinvar. It's written by Sir Walter Scott. So let's begin.
O young Lochinvar is come out of the west. Through all the wide border his steed was the best. And save his good broadsword, he weapons had none. He rode all unarmed and he rode all alone. So faithful in love and so dauntless in war. There never was knight like the young Lochinvar.
The poem starts with the introduction of Lochinvar, who is a courageous knight. Now, who is a knight? A man of high social position, trained to fight as a soldier on a horse. So Lochinvar is described as a courageous knight and undeterred romantic. Okay, so his coming from the west is a metaphor which resembles him for being like sun. Okay, very strong. Now he came all through the wide border in the west, riding unarmed on his horse. He came alone. He carried no weapons throughout the special journey, though he was well versed in engaging in armed combat. So he was a knight. So obviously there will be fights and the entire troop. But he was all alone here. He is so faithful to the girl he loves and fearless at the same time. Now in every war he fought for the country, he is known for being gallant and dauntless, and there has been never such a knight so brave like Lochinvar. He stayed not for brick and he stopped not for stone. He swam the Esk river where ford there was none. But ere he alighted at Netherby gate, the bride had consented, the gallant came late. For a laggard in love and a dastard in war was to wed the fair Ellen of brave Lochinvar. In the second stanza of the poem, the writer tells that Lochinvar is so valiant that no obstacle could stop him from reaching the desired goal. Throughout the journey, he didn't stay back for anything and didn't stop for any hardship that prevented him to reach his goal. He swam across the deep Esk river bravely and without any fear, and the river had no shallow place where no one can walk or drive across. So however, before the young Lochinvar reached the Netherby gate and alighted himself on the horse, the bride Ellen had considered him as a gallant who had arrived late, and straggler who fought cowardly and disgracefully in the war of love for the bride. Now he was to take the fair Ellen's hand in marriage. So boldly he entered the Netherby hall. Among bride's men and kinsmen and brothers and all, then spoke the bride's father, his hand on his sword. For the poor craven bridegroom said never a word. O come ye in peace here, or come ye in war, or to dance at our bridal, young Lord Lochinvar. In the third stanza, Lochinvar entered the Netherby hall so boldly in the presence of the bride's men and kinsmen. Kinsmen are nothing but relatives, and her brothers and all her relatives. So all were standing there. And the poor bridegroom didn't utter a single word, and the bride's father, who was not pleased with Lochinvar's arrival, stood up with his hand gripping his sword and asked him whether he came here in peace or an intention of war or to dance at their bridal. I long wooed your daughter, my suit you denied. Love swells like the Solway, but ebbs like its tide. And now am I come with this lost love of mine to lead but one measure, drink one cup of wine. There are maidens in Scotland more lovely by far that would gladly be bride to the young Lochinvar. In the fourth stanza, Lochinvar was equally defiant and bold in his reply, and said that he long wooed Ellen. That is, long back he liked Ellen, but his rightful suit was denied. That is, his proposal they had rejected. So the king had previously rejected his marriage proposal. Now the love which was not encouraged would soon die, and he had now come to have a dance and drink a cup of wine at the marriage feast. He was happy for her. He also added, there are many suitable maidens in Scotland. Now who are maidens? Young females. So he is telling that there are many suitable females in Scotland who are more beautiful and desirable than your daughter Ellen, who would gladly be his bride. They would happily agree to marry Lochinvar. The bride kissed the goblet. The knight took it up. He quaffed off the wine and he threw down the cup. She looked down to blush and she looked up to sigh, with a smile on her lips and a tear in her eye. He took her soft hand, here her mother could bar. Now tread we a measure, said young Lochinvar. Okay. In the fifth stanza, Ellen kissed the goblet. Goblet is nothing but a wine glass. So she kissed it and offered that glass of wine to Lochinvar. He accepted it, drank the wine quickly. Then he threw the glass in anger and was annoyed by the fact that Ellen betrayed his love and married another man. He was really upset. Then, however, he offered her a final dance together. So he asked, let's dance. Ellen was filled with emotions now. She had a smile on her face. She had a smile on her lips and she kept blushing. But these emotions were clearly signifying the upwelling affections for Lochinvar. And Lochinvar took one dance with Ellen after she blessed his wine. That is, she had that smile on her face, but inside her heart she was crying. She had a tear in her eye because she is leaving her love and marrying somebody else. So stately his form and so lovely her face, that never a hall such a galliard did grace. While her mother did fret and her father did fume, and the bridegroom stood dangling his bonnet and plume. And the bride maidens whispered, 'twere better by far to have matched our fair cousin with young Lochinvar. In the sixth stanza, both Ellen and Lochinvar danced together, and Lochinvar's stature and strength complemented Ellen's poise and grace so well that the whole hall was sparkled with their starry presence. Now, when Ellen was dancing with him, her mother was fretting. That is, she was angry. Her father also was angry. He was fumed at the sight. And the bridegroom stood there dangling, but they could not do anything to drive a wedge between the reunited lovers. He could not separate them. Now the bridesmaids were entranced by the perfect match, and there were soft cries of admiration as they feel that the young daring Lochinvar was a better match for Ellen. So the bridesmaid who was standing there, the audience were almost saying that these two are made for each other. They make a perfect match. One touch to her hand and one word in her ear. When they reached the hall door and the charger stood near, so light to the croup the fair lady he swung, so light to the saddle before her he sprung. She is won. We are gone over bank, bush, and scaur. They will have fleet steeds that follow, quoth young Lochinvar. In the seventh stanza, Lochinvar touched Ellen's hand softly and spoke a word in her ear. It feels as if she was hypnotized by his love, and they both walked steadily, reached the door of the hall. That is, dancingly, they reached the door of the hall, encountered the charger who stood there. Charger is a person who was standing at the entrance like a watchman, and reached for Lochinvar's horse. So they fought, he fought him, and then they went to the horse. Lochinvar flung Ellen on the horse and rose to take the reins in his hands and loudly announced that he had won back his love. So what did he do? He just took Ellen, carried her and put her in the horse. He too sat on the horse and loudly he shouted that he has got his love back. He rode as hard as he could over the bank of river, bushes and mountains to get away from the chasing pack of Ellen's kinsmen. That is all the Ellen's family. They also started chasing them to catch the bride and he was riding his horse very fast. There was mounting among Greems of the Netherby clan, Fosters, Fenwicks and Musgraves. They rode and they ran. There was racing and chasing on Canobie Lee, but the lost bride of Netherby never did they see. So daring in love and so dauntless in war. Have you ever heard of gallant like young Lochinvar? In the last stanza, the associates of the Netherby clan, including Fosters, Fenwicks and Musgraves, all these families, they too mounted their horses and rode as fast as they could to arrest that couple. But the couple was never seen again in that region. They just vanished, disappeared. So there was chasing and chasing on Canobie Lee. Canobie Lee is a village near that Esk River. So they were just chasing them, but at once they got vanished. So a man so daring in love and so dauntless in war, and there is truly no one who could match him in terms of heroism, romanticism and gallantry. That is his bravery. I hope you liked this video and understood the explanation. Thank you. So I request, if you really liked it, so please like, comment and subscribe to my channel. Thank you.